Greetings, fellow modelers and YouTubers. This is the first video in over a month. Why? Because Windows 10 decided to update and took out all of my data on two different hard drives. Don't you just love Microsoft? I don't. All right, I just put this video together. I just got Windows Movie Maker working today, as of the posting of this video. I've been working on recovering data on two different hard drives for a month. Okay? Now, I tried to put as much as I could in this video and appease as many people as possible, but I can't please everybody all the time, and I'm not going to try. What you see is what you get. Okay, this is it until the next video. I'm sorry. There's a lot more to come. There is a lot more to come. So please be patient. Give me a chance to maneuver, and you will see more, much, much more. 's have a look at some brass etch. I've started doing brass back in, I don't know, 2006, and I didn't stick with it, and then again about 2009 and 12, 14, 15, and in 15 I came up with a brass pattern. Well, essentially it was a laser cut pattern for the 1:1, 1/3, and 1/6 scale Nomad, all of the above, taken directly from a high resolution picture of Captain Kirk and the Nomad. It just happened to be almost perfectly level with the camera and centered properly to get a really good tracing from the pattern. I sent that to my buddy Bill Perry, who went in and did it in Adobe Illustrator, as I didn't have an active copy of Adobe Illustrator at the time. He sent it back to me, and I sent it off to a corporation here locally that does precision metal work. They use their machines to precision laser cut full scale and 1/6 scale patterns. I also sent the pattern to my friend Elliot Brown, and Elliot Brown made up several sheets of brass for me. But as you can see, he did credit me for the artwork back in 2015. Now, I'm only showing this and bringing this up because I had someone who works in brass etching decide he was going to run me into the ground and give me a hard time. So I have decided that, yes, I'm going to get back into brass etching, and I'm going to make my own patterns and etch my own brass, and I'm going to show you exactly how to do it and how to do it cheaply and economically. It's just a little bit of work and a little bit of thought, and you can make all kinds of brass patterns for anything you could possibly want and not pay the overhead for the other guys to do it. Anyway, we will be seeing much more of this. Alrighty then, I wanted to put the brass etch into a little perspective. Now, as you can see here, I'm doing finish work on the 1/6 Nomad, which is studio accurate, two screenshots and accurate to the 1:1 and 1/3 scale Nomads. All the same CG model, same patterns, same everything. Everything, I worked on this with two or three different guys, Thunderchild, myself, Bill Perry, and Elliot Brown did the actual brass work for me, but I'm going to be doing my own again, as I stated previously. Now, I found that picture of the Nomad after this had been created, this whole screen and mesh grid pattern had been created. Now, if you look here, this brass, even though it's a little oxidized and or discolored, the pattern is much more accurate than what the original pattern was when the model was built. So there you go. I will be covering this with chrome and lightly sanding it with about 1000 grit sandpaper just to kind of rough it up a little bit and then kind of try to polish it just slightly to give it that look of aluminum. I also have some aluminum plates that were precision laser cut alongside the full scale 1:1 plates. So I may use those. Who knows? We shall see. I'm going to be sectioning this and doing final cleanup on it and getting it ready to mold once again, because I've done this before. Well, look what's came in the last week. Lots of supplies, and this is only part of it. I've got soundboards, I've got more circuit boards, more light strips, more RGB light strips, super bright white light strips, super bright blue light strips. I got power supplies, I got 44 button remote for remote control, RGB lighting. I've got a new stand that's going to go with the Katinga. All of this just came in within the last week. I've got a couple more things that are coming in. Some of this was ordered by my clients as additions to their builds, and some of it was ordered by me. And we will see all of this in action as the builds progress. So there will be more to come on the electronics, the lighting, the soundboards, etc., etc. Now I've got another strip I'm going to do a demonstration on in just a minute. Okay, so I want to do a quick follow-up on the TIE Fighter, Studio Scale TIE Fighter. I made a permanent or semi-permanent pattern, as I showed in a previous video, just by using masking tape and then running a felt tip pen along the center line all the way around this piece. Each one of these is perfectly equal to the next one, so each one of these pieces is perfectly equal to the next. And I cut up 8 of these from this pattern, and what I will do is I will go through, clean up each and every one of these, make sure that they're squared away and ready to be glued into place and or epoxied, and I will do just that. Now, this is the last piece. You can see I made a template for the center as well. Boop, boop. And this is overcut just a little bit because this is going to be the last piece that will go in, and I will have to trim it down correspondingly depending on how much overlap I may have in any of these areas around this pattern. We will see this again. More to come. All right, I'm getting ready to add the windows into this front window section, observation frame or what have you, for the studio scale TIE fighter. Yes, there have been times when I called it an X-Wing, just misspoke. Now I've got 7 of these, I had 8. I'm guessing 7 of the windows, separate windows. Guessing my cat got a hold of one. I'm gonna go ahead and cut up a couple of extras. I'm gonna cut up another one of these. I'm gonna place each one of these windows one at a time after I thoroughly clean them with Windex. Very carefully put each one into place and align and trim and cut the next one that will sit next to it. All right, we're getting ready to see 5 minutes worth of Star Wars audio for one model build. All 4 channels, everything that's included, 294 seconds of audio. Next button. Next button. And now the final ending. Now that's just through the onboard speaker with no housing, no speaker housing. Now when there's a speaker housing and it's built into the base, it's going to sound so much better. And then there's a jack in the back. If you jack in your stereo or your sound system or headphones or computer speakers, it's going to sound so much better. The awesome part of this whole build is that when the blasters fire, the lights on the actual TIE fighter fire. The engines are on all the time. The interior lighting's on all the time. But as soon as the blasters fire, the on the soundboard, the blasters fire on the model. Now, is that awesome or what? In the next video, I'm going to show the interaction between the soundboard and the sound-alike circuit. Much more to come, as always. Let's have a look at the Martian War Machine from War of the Worlds. What was it, 2005? Was it that long ago? Wow. At any rate, here is the Martian War Machine. And I've pulled this out of mothballs, more or less, because I'm getting ready to wrap up at least three different client builds, like toot sweet, really quick. So I started looking at how to light this and make it look right. Now, I went back to the DVD / Blu-ray extras and everything else, and I saw that indeed there was more than one color. So I ordered some purple LEDs and picked out some of the other LEDs that I have here, all about the same size, and wanted to kind of put everything in context. This is supposed to be purple. Now, I'm not colorblind. In fact, I've got excellent vision, color recognition, the whole bit. But that just doesn't look purple enough for me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the purple, the blue, and the red, and try to get them set up in such a way that they all kind of blend together as we go across this shape and form of the carapace of the Martian War Machine. Because there's more than just one color. In fact, you see yellow, amber, orange, red, green, blue. It shifts and changes over time, and each one of these machines looks a little bit different. All this was done in CG, but I'm going to do my best to match the colors that come up underneath the translucent areas, as you see in the video, with purple, blue, and red LEDs. May even throw in a yellow and an amber. I will be putting a green LED down inside of here when this is all assembled and said and done. So we will be seeing more of this as soon as I finish up at least three model builds and custom bases. So once again, more to come. Okay, so this just came in today for the 1/350th Katinga build. I'm going to have to separate all these pieces that screw together, mask off the screw areas and or the female ends, and paint each one of these sections flat black. I will not be using this rubber piece. I will use this. This will mount to the bottom of the base. This will come up through the custom Klingon symbol base. I won't use this. All of this I will send back to the client with the finished build. So we will see this on the Katinga model base, and it'll be black. Woohoo! So I just shot all the white parts for the Klingon Katinga model base bracket camera shifty thingy flat black. So I'm getting ready. They've been laying out here to dry all day. Getting ready to take them back in, do a little pre-assembly. This will go into the actual new Katinga model base. There we go. Then the shaft will come up. The shaft will protrude up through the model base and into the bottom of the Katinga. Well, look what we have here. The Bandai X-Wing Starfighter 1/48 scale moving edition. Oh my. Alrighty then. I'm sorry, I can't help myself. I tickle myself sometimes. It's true. Anyway, I opened the box. I looked inside. Now, when I got this box, it wasn't taped together. There was no cellophane. There was no plastic covering. This was sold not as is, but new. So, you know, I don't know if they had it open or what. I don't know how this comes from the factory, but I would think it would be sealed. If your version of this was sealed, please let me know. I'm not going to report the guy, but, you know, if you're going to sell stuff as new, it should be new. Anyway, let's move all the boxes and everything out of the way and have a quick look at what we've got going on here. Alrighty then, here are the parts. Still on their trees. Directions, decals, details, etc. And the main model base, electronics, stand, and actuator. Now, I want to go ahead and look at some of these parts. I'm not going to make a big deal of it. It's a standard Bandai quality, although much of the model is already pre-painted. I'm going to go through and do like a normal build and paint everything. I mean, just everything. There's no sense in doing a snap together kit of something this intricate and involved. I want to do it right. I want to make it look studio accurate. Now, I'll tell you, for a 1/48 scale, this seems awfully friggin' small to me. Considering the price, now, this sells for about $100, $100 and a quarter. I got it for less than that, far less than that. Look at that. That's the main fuselage, lower section of the main fuselage. Not very big, so this gives you got a scale figure right here. I'm guessing that's appropriate or correct. But I don't know, the model seems awful small. I'm going to have to create my own 1/24th scale. Scratch built from Battlefront 2 X-Wing model, ripped out of the video game. Brought into Pepakura, unfolded, and built in styrene. Anyway, parts is parts. We've seen parts on parts trees before. Directions. Seems to be mostly Japanese. So, I mean, it's still easy to build. I mean, it's just follow the pictures. 1, 2, 3. I don't know anybody could have a problem with building this, but there's some fellers out there, I reckon, that don't have the capacity to read directions and follow instructions. I feel for those guys, poor guys. Anyway, really nice instruction booklet. Unfortunately, in Japanese. I don't see English on here anywhere. Oh, there is some English, a little bit. Oh yeah, there we go. You got the English derivative directly underneath. My bad. All right, so it shouldn't be hard at all. Well, for most people. Now let's have a look. Man, there's a lot of decals on here. Lots of decals. This gives you every detail possible. Even the decals of the interior of the cockpit. Now I've got my own cockpit, naturally, and I ripped one out of Battlefront 2, so I will show that another time. At any rate, I will be printing my own cockpit for this. That's a fact. All right, let's go ahead and look at the electronic actuator. All right. So, you got lights. Got your photon torpedo launcher. No phaser controller, blasters, laser blasters, whatever. Now, the audio doesn't quite match the actual function, so I'm probably going to pull everything out of this board, use my own soundboard, match the audio to the sound, or the audio to the action, and try to add some laser blasters out of the tips of the X-Wing. Because, this is great for a $100 kit. You can't beat it. Better than what you get from Schmobius models or Polar Aurora for $100. Anyway, there it is. The Bandai Lights and Sounds Moving X-Wing Starfighter. We will see more of this in the future. More to come. Oh my. Okay, so I'm getting ready to hit this with a couple more coats of wood filler. Finish sanding it once and for all. Spray paint it sand colored. Then I'm going to cut two pieces of wood for either side of that hole, that notch where the Guardian sits in, front and back. Cut the pieces, drill them, drill out the Guardian and the backing plate, get those ready to mount. And then I'm going to cut a piece of veneer to go all along the outside of this frame. I'm also going to be cutting veneer for the studio scale TIE fighter base and a couple of other things. Now I got a couple of things to show you real quick back to back, because I want to put an end to all this jumping around. I want to get as much into every video as I can and make sure I've got copies of everything, so that when I edit everything together, it'll go clickety-click, clickety-click. Alrighty then, I've been out here working on both of these projects today. I've got the model base completely assembled. What I did was I took a piece of 80,000 styrene and secured it to the top of the wooden base with some drywall screws. I used a larger drill bit to act as a countersink, used the drywall screws to hold everything into place, and then used epoxy and super glue to epoxy and super glue the resin pieces to the polystyrene. Now I'm going to take that in and do a light wash. I've got about three or four different coats of gray on it right now. I'm going to take this in and do a light wash on this. On the 125th scale Guardian gate, I had to go over the entire thing again. I had to sand it down, chip it out, because the humidity got into it over the summer and the paint cracked and split again. So this is going to stay in the house until it's done. And this is going to get done toot sweet. I've already got the electronics ready to roll, and I got the other parts inside that I'm getting ready to drill through and set up permanently into place. So we'll see more of these, both of these projects, coming up soon. Alrighty then, I'm preparing to do a black wash over these three, four different shades of gray and or black. All I have is some acrylic black paint and water and a raggedy paintbrush. I'm gonna do the wash, come back, show it. The next thing I'm going to do is there's gonna be a rail going around the entire thing made of thin underlayment that's gonna set everything off, and I'll paint that whatever color the client wants. Alrighty, so I just put the wash on. I'm gonna let that dry, and then I'll probably go over it a couple more times. I'll lighten it up here a little bit, darken it up there. Star Wars is very much a used universe. In other words, it's supposed to look old and tired and weathered and worn. Now you can obviously see that, say, the Death Star was built in sections. Who knows, probably sections built on one planet, built on another planet, built on a moon, built in space. All these little separate, disparate parts or sections that make up the whole are not going to look exactly like each other. So you're going to have darker areas and lighter areas. At any rate, we will get a look at this when it's totally done and I'm satisfied with it. I think this really adds detail and makes all the fine detail really pop, and makes the base set off the model, so that the model and the base together make for an awesome display. So now the paint is dried, And I'm getting ready to go over different places with a couple of grades of sandpaper to lighten a couple of different places and give it some direction, as in forward and backward, because the TIE fighter is going to sit right in the center facing forward. So I want to give it a little bit of direction. Just because, well, to add to the effect of the TIE fighter flying over the surface of the Death Star, but also to break up some of the splotchiness from the different layers and to kind of give it, like I say, some direction. This adds to the effect of flying and shooting lasers, phasers, blasters, what have you. So let me do that. Then I'm going to go back over a couple places and add some more wash, and then sand and scrape away some of the wash to get the effect that I'm looking for, which is a weathered Death Star. Here is the TIE fighter model base. I'm getting ready to cut the veneer for this entire thing, just like the Guardian Gate base and the original series full scale lights and sounds unit, wall unit. Now, we'll see both of these after all the veneer is cut and nailed in with finish nails. I'm not going to paint either one of these. I've got too much time and money invested into both of these projects to keep adding extras. So I'm just going to set it up to get it finished and get it ready to ship. I've got to touch up a couple of places, and then I'm going to go over with the sandpaper one last time and get some directional flow with the sandpaper to look like, you know, TIE fighters flying through. More to come. Alrighty, here is the 1/350th Battleship New Jersey, BB-62. Now, this is a big model. What I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna go ahead and pull the box open and get a look at all the parts inside, the directions, etc. This is a Tamiya kit. I got this really cheap considering what it retailed for, and I'm really happy with it. This is my first large-scale Tamiya kit, so I'm gonna go freehand and we'll have a look at this. And here we are. Here is the large main hull, bags of parts, decals, directions, more stuff for you to buy, and the stand. Now let's have a look. I mean, naturally this is a Tamiya kit, so you expect quality and detail, and that's what you get. Quality and detail. Now I'm going to make up my own brass etch for this, working with my friend Bill Perry and or Thunderchild, we shall see. But this is the kit. This is it. This is the kit. There ain't no more. That's all there is to show. And it's a detailed kit. Nice kit. I've looked through all of this. The box was sealed when I got it, but whoever had this must have had it in the garage for, God, 10, 20 years. I think this kit was made in 84, 85. Just about the time I was getting out of active duty and going in the reserves. I saw this massive beast out at sea and in the Philippines. And a good friend of mine, when I was in the reserves, got stationed on the Mighty Mo BB-63. And I felt real bad for him because I told him that's going to be the Admiral's ship and it's going to be all spit and polish night and day. When I finally heard back from him, he told me I was absolutely right. It was constant, non-stop drilling, polishing, cleaning, preventative maintenance, non-stop. There you go. Here you see the frosted dome that is going to be the old school base for the 1/1000 original series, not refit. Sorry all you Star Trek hardcore guys. I got the tools, parts, and equipment nomenclature wrong. I made a mistake. I said the wrong thing. It is not the 1-1000 refit. It is the 1-1000 original series production version, kinda. Actually, it's gonna be my own version because it's my model, and I'm gonna build it my way and put my own decals on it. And I'm gonna show you how to do that too. Now, as you can see, we've got about an 8.54 diameter exterior circumference at this point. This is deeper. I'm going to cut a hole out of here, slide this up from underneath. There will be a buffer in between to cover for the thickness of this spheroid hemisphere plate. And then I will lay it on top of the mirror acrylic after it's been sanded and frosted. I will then shoot the whole thing, not the hemisphere, flat black, and just use different size drill bits and filter material to come up with different colored, different sized stars in the sky. Now, isn't that brilliant? And so much cheaper than trying to buy the appropriately sized computer monitor or used television set. More to come. Oh, by the way, this is the soundboard for the Aries. I'm gonna be working on this tonight. Now, recently I had some douchebag on Facebook decide to start talking smack about me again. So guess what? I bought a MicroMark brass etch kit. So I'm gonna be showing you guys how to make your own brass for any model you want, cheap and easy, compared to what you have into it, to what you can get out of it. A hell of a lot cheaper than paying the price for some of these guys to make little bitty bits of brass etch and sell them to you for 30, 40, 50 bucks. Now, every time one of these guys comes at me, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna show exactly how easy it is for you to do your own. Oh, by the way, I will be selling one-to-one Mobius models, HAL 9000 pre-programmed soundboards, and making custom programmed soundboards for any model build, genre, or anything you can think of for a nominal fee. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, and what you see in the foreground is what used to be the inside of an old Dell computer monitor. This is the framing that went around it in the gasket. Now, I've seen a guy on the internet making a big deal out of using these. Why won't it focus? There, that'll give us something to focus on. Okay, seen a guy making a big deal out of taking these used TVs and used computer monitors to make light panels. Now, I got to thinking, I've been doing this kind of thing for a lot of years, electronics and engineering and all that, and I came up with a better, faster, cheaper, more brilliant way of doing exactly the same thing without paying for the monitor and or tools, parts, equipment, nomenclature. What we're going to do instead of using the computer monitor is we're going to use some sheets of 1/8-inch acrylic and mirror backing. Let me get to that coming up next. All right, I picked up some more supplies lately and or ordered and have had some more supplies shipped in. Electronics, acrylic, etc., etc., yada, yada, yada. What we have here is this beautiful Klingon symbol. This is going to be part of the Katinga backlit model base. But there's going to be an extra, but I'm not going to tell you what it is. Now, what you see is two sheets of 1/8-inch by 12 by 24 acrylic sheet, gloss. Two and one sheet of mirrored acrylic 1/8-inch with a clear covering. Sheet one is going to go on the top. Sheet 3, the mirrored acrylic, is going to go underneath. All I'm going to do is use an orbital sander after pulling off the tape, the protective coating and covering. Use an orbital sander to go over the 1/8 inch acrylic on both sides to frost it up real well. No need for vellum, no need for a diffuser, no need for anything extra but what you have right here and some sandpaper. Then I'm going to take the super bright white 600 per 5 meter unit of LED strip and wrap it around this to direct all the light inward, and then use the mirror to reflect it all back out. This is going to be used on, or part of it's going to be used on the Klingon model base. Part of it's going to be used on what's coming up next. And here's a quick follow-up on the R5D4, approximately 1/4 square, 1/4 scale. Now, what I'm going to do is, I've already laid out the cart model template on a piece of 30,000 styrene and marked where I'm going to cut. This is exactly the length and width of this part here. I'm going to use an X-Acto to cut out all the cutouts on this card model, then mark this piece of plastic. So while I'm building this Schedule 40 sized R5D4, I will also be scratch building the main body and other components for a fully scratch built 30,000 polystyrene R5D4 model.